Thank you. Thank you, Luis, for this kind presentation. And thank you, thanks to the organizers for this opportunity to be here today and share with you some thoughts about past, present, and future of AI. Many of the things I will say are, say, my own feelings or my own opinions about AI. Not everyone has to agree on that, of course. Although I've been talking to quite a few colleagues along many years, and I can tell you that many of the things that I will mention to you today are shared by many of my colleagues anyway. So hopefully, fortunately. Okay, let's go then. I will very, very briefly mention where we come from. I think it's always nice to know where we come from, so that, you know, it's clear that we are not inventing everything ourselves. We have not invented everything in the last 10 or 15 years. Sometimes it seems like, but it's not true. Things come from very, very, very back in the days, like in, as you will see, in the late 40s already. Some visionaries like Turing already anticipated. He basically anticipated everything we are doing now. We'll see that there are two approaches to AI. One is the one that everybody knows, and all the achievements of AI belong to one of the approaches. And the other one is the old approach that the romantic ideas about what AI should be, in fact, and what are the founding fathers of AI thought that AI should be. Or would be, which is will be the strong view, as we will see. Then I will briefly remind some of the achievements of the AI that we as we know it now, which is this weak AI, and then talk a little bit about the long road ahead, the future, and what are, in my opinion, is the stepping stone that is needed to achieve eventually these strong AI ideas. And then some conclusions. So as I said, Alan Turing, that everyone knows about him in this audience, of course, in 48, in an unpublished technical report, not very well known. Well, he's much well known for another paper, Computer Machinery and Intelligence, where he proposed the famous Turing test. But I think, in my opinion, this paper from 48, which is a previous to the other one, to the 1950 paper, he said many interesting things in this paper. This paper already anticipated that there would be computers capable of performing logical deductions, acquire new knowledge. So there's something wrong in the speaker, maybe this. Okay. Yes, acquiring new knowledge inductively, also learning by experience, by evolution, capable of communicating by means of what he was mentioning, humanized interfaces. That includes natural language, of course, and vision and gestural even. He also speculated about the connection between randomness and computational creativity and creative intelligent computers that could perform a creative task, could be creative. You can read here how he thought this randomness could be implemented could materialize in a computer by suggesting to add a radioactive element like radium into the DAs, this computer he was working with, in the hope that the random decay of the radioactivity of the radiation would be useful for introduce randomness into the systems. He also speculated in the subsequent and better known paper, 1950 paper published in Mind magazine, about the emulation of the mind of a child. He thought that emulating an adult brain, it was too complicated, but perhaps it was easier to emulate a child's brain and then put this machine or this robot in an appropriate setting. Culturization and through experience would become eventually an adult brain, so an adult intelligence. This has to do with something called developmental psychology, as you know. And actually nowadays there is a field, a relatively new field. It started in 21st century, so from 2001 started to develop, which is called developmental robotics, that is trying to do precisely what Turing already mentioned in 1950. So I think it's clear that Turing had many insights into what AI would be 50 years or even 60 years later, right? Of course, he was not the only one to have this long-term vision. In precisely in the same year that he wrote his report in 1948, there was a symposium at Caltech in California, this Hyson Symposium on Cerebral Mechanisms, where people like McCulloch, von Neumann, Lashley, and others already thought about many things that nowadays are important in AI. We can say that, for example, that Lashley set up the foundations of what is now called cognitive science by criticizing and showing the limitations of conductism, for example. There was in 1955 a computer conference in LA where people that later went to Dartmouth and were the initiators of AI, like Oliver Selfridge or Alan Newell, Pitts of the McCallum and Pitts, that were the origins of neural networks, right? Already were talking about neural networks, about even chess. Newell was already explaining that how a computer could play chess, in 1955, right? Then the year later in 56 is the well-known and the official date of the birth of AI at the famous Dartmouth conference. And then we can recognize here the founding fathers of AI: John McCarthy, Marvin Minsky, Alan Newell, Herbert Simon, Shaw, Oliver Selfridge, Ray Solomonoff, Nathaniel Rochester, Claude Shannon, Arthur Samuel, and Bernstein. All these people were already in this conference, as you, I'm sure many of you know, there were many interesting papers being presented or being discussed, or ideas. Not everything had the form of a standard conference paper. For example, Arthur Samuel showed this famous checkers playing program that was playing checker at very high level. And by the way, it was using some sort of reinforcement learning that playing against itself could learn. And AlphaGo is doing that. So the AlphaGo people didn't invent at all, neither reinforcement learning, neither neural networks, and neither the fact that one machine can play by playing against itself, a copy of itself, of the software, can learn, right? So I think it's good to know that. So in the 50s already, all these things that now we are dealing with in AI were actually present, were invented then, not now. Okay, so Dartmouth, as I said, as many of you know, is the official birth of AI. And since then, many things have happened, of course. But I think, in my opinion, we can distinguish two periods of AI, or two ways of considering AI, of two approaches to AI, or two views. One is the view of these founding fathers, all these names that were mentioned in the previous slide. They said that it's the science of engineering of replicating and even surpassing human-level intelligence in machine. This is what is known as the strong AI view, right? What happened is that at that time, many of these founding fathers, they were maybe too optimistic about the future development of AI, and they created over expectations about what AI could do in relatively short time. We're talking about in 30, 40 years' time, we will have that and that and that. So many, many things that were not, didn't happen, right? What happened then in the 80s is that because of these over expectations and other, not the only reason, but because of other reasons too that I will not mention because of lack of time, it happened what is known in the history of AI as the AI winter. So funding of AI decreased a lot, drastically. There were some reports that they're criticizing very heavily AI that was useless. Some of the reports were really harsh. Some philosophers were also arguing and mentioning limitations of AI. And all this contributed to this AI winter. And that made a shift in the in what AI was going to be. Instead of, you know, instead of trying to reach this strong AI dream or ambition, the community of AI turned into, let's say, more modest objectives or goals. And we can say that as a result of this, AI became the science and engineering of designing machines with the capability to perform tasks that were done, when done by humans, these tasks, we agree that they require intelligence. So this is what later was called weak AI by some people. Yeah? And well, as you can see, there are two completely different ways of approaching AI, two completely different views. The strong one that emphasizes, as I said, the human level AI, enriching the human level AI, or even surpassing it, refers to general intelligence, not a specific. The aspect is one characteristic of human intelligence. It has this flexibility or generality characteristic. You know, they were also saying that intelligent machines will have mental states. Not simulate, not emulate, really have them, have mental state, consciousness, etc. This all is based on the very well-known in AI physical symbol systems hypothesis by Newell and Simon that says intelligence does not depend on the substrate where it is, where it resides. It doesn't matter whether it is the brain, whether it are cells, which are biological cells, or transistors in a chip, in silicon, right? It doesn't matter. Is an hypothesis. So the physical symbol hypothesis is still an hypothesis. And it's the working hypothesis of AI, actually. So what is AI about? I mean, the general approach, the strong AI endeavor and goal is try to verify this hypothesis. We may or we may not. I don't really know, okay? Whether or not this strong AI hypothesis is feasible, is achievable or not. You know, you have to think that this is like the origin of life, the origin of the universe is one of the big questions of science. It's comparable to this other big questions, whether or not this strong human level AI is achievable or not, whether or not these machines will have mental states, consciousness, and all that. In my opinion, it's comparable in difficulty, in complexity, in importance to all the other big questions in science, right? And so it's what motivates at least people like me. It doesn't motivate to everyone in the field, as I will mention later, okay? The only examples we have nowadays of this human level, general AI, strong AI, whatever you want to call it, are the robots in movies and machines that we see in movies, right? So it's science fiction nowadays. Okay. But inspires, as I said, still inspires are the work of some of us in AI at least. Maybe the ones that are more older and romantic, I don't know. The weak AI is, as I said, is very different. Okay, I underline a specialized intelligence instead of the general intelligence that was underlined in the previous slide. So this is the big point. This is the big difference among these both approaches. And we have already, as all of you very well know, and you are also doing it, you know, we have lots of weak AI examples which are extremely impressive, which has given impressive results already, right? So let's see a little bit. Of course, I cannot go in detail and you know, exhaustively, because there are too many, thousands of these impressive results along the travel road so far on this weak AI, right? Here are a few examples, very obviously very few, and that I think many of them have in common that AI is there, but is not always visible. This is something that is plays a little bit against us. There is a lot of achievements of AI that are not visible at all. Nobody knows almost about, except the ones that we are working in AI. But I mean, not the public, not the people, right? like you can, I will not read all of them one by one, but you can see it, you know, and you will recognize many of them. Maybe you will not recognize all of them, even yourselves. Maybe even yourselves, you didn't know that AI was so playing an important role. I don't know, in jet turbines, in jet turbines of airplanes, for example. Or maybe not everyone knows that a very complex mathematical theorem, that's the Robbins conjecture, that has been for 60 years, no human mathematician was capable of proving, was proved by a theorem prover, which is called EQP, which is a first-order logic with equality, with the predicate of equality, is what is called equational logic. And they try, and they prove that Robbins algebras are Boolean algebras. It's a very complex theorem that was proved by a computer. I mean, autonomously, 100% proven by the computer. Not like the four-color theorem that was humans aided by computers that were capable of proving it. This was a standalone proof by a machine, right? An ML system also, that's quite interesting. It was a machine learning system that analyzed the passing patterns in soccer teams, actually from the Spanish league. And then they figured out that Atletico de Madrid, for example, uses much less recurrent patterns than other teams. No more than 30-something patterns that are repeated. But Barcelona, for example, and Madrid, they use more than 100. This means that it's more difficult to predict the passing patterns of Atletico de Madrid than Barcelona and Real Madrid, right? So that's quite an interesting thing, I think. Well, it's curious, at least, right? Then, the last two, which is, I have it highlighted, is some work that I'm going to show you now, a video and some music. This is what we have done at my institute, and that I think it's worth to see the capabilities of an AI technique called similarity-based reasoning or similarity-based learning, or analogical learning. In this one, we will see how robots are capable of learning to pass a ball, so to do intended passing behavior. Normally in robot soccer, when you see that a ball is kicked by a team member, and then a teammate catches the ball and kicks the ball, say, oh, they have passed the ball one to another. No, in most of the time, this is just by chance. There is not an intention to pass the ball. It happens that the ball lands or near as the teammate sees the ball, goes and kicks the ball. So, but this was not planned. It was not planned to do that, just by chance, no? In this world, however, all the passing behavior, all the passings are really planned. So there is really cooperative or collaborative playing that is going on there. Depending on the situation, the robots decide whether or not a passing is feasible or it should be done. Maybe it's better to play individually in some cases, and in some cases, depending on the position of the ball, the position of the teammates, and the position of the other team, the members of the other team, the adversaries, it's better or not to pass. So these decisions are taken very fast in real time, because otherwise the other team could steal you the ball, right? So you better be fast in doing that. And it really works. It really works. It's really feasible. Well, this is the plan that is going to be executed. And you see, this is an intended pass. It's not by chance. Okay. In the second case, the situation is such that it's better to progress the ball towards the goal individually. Now it tries to score, but it was almost not seen. The goalkeeper was in good position, so he could. And now this second one, the third gameplay, finally scores. So there have been a sequence of three gameplays. These robots have learned 136 gameplays by playing, okay? And then they have stored all the situations where these gameplays were taken and were successful. And in the real setting when they have to play. They have to compute. They have to realize whether or not the situation is similar. Which is the most similar situation of the 136 that they have learned that is more similar to the one they are in at this moment, the situation they are at this moment dealing with. And then recovers, they retrieve one of several of these possible gameplays. They decide which one is the will that will do. Among if there are several that are equally, in principle, equally feasible, there is a notion of cost involved in the decision, and they take the one that has the lower cost. They reproduce this one, and so on and so forth. So every time they retrieve a gameplay, they perform it, and then they retrieve a second one. They perform it. Here we have seen three retrievals and three gameplays, one in sequence that until scoring a goal. This is, as I said, is similarity-based reasoning. Case-based reasoning. There is another example that uses the same technique, and this is quite interesting because it is a way of performing music that sounds expressive. That at the input you give an inexpressive performance of a score, and the system contains examples of human player playing the same style of music, not the same score, the same style of music. Other compositions, but that belong to the same, that all of them are jazz ballads. And by analyzing, by using new musical knowledge, the system is capable of knowing in each bar which is the most important note, which is the second most important note. It detects obviously the duration of the notes. It detects whether or not the note is dissonant or consonant with respect to the chord. So the chords are written on top, right? All this is musical knowledge that the system uses in order to find out which one of the interpretations of the human is the closest one, which score that is in the examples has most similar characteristics to this score. And it's based on the idea that similar problems should have similar solutions. That's quite similarity-based reasoning. And, well, whenever they found a human interpretation who is performing a score which is similar to this one, it looks, analyzes what the human did, whether the human added a vibrato in a long note or they played the notes more or less linked, was legato or staccato, whether or not the sound of a note was increased with respect to other one, a crescendo, it's called that. Well, there are like five different ways of playing each one of the notes that are taken into consideration. And what it does, the system, it imitates the way, the solution of the human. And it delivers, at the output, an interpretation that is different, from the input, and it has more expressiveness. Okay, the input one sounds neutral, sounds sort of boring, sort of a little bit bored, and the other ones have more. Like in one case, I selected two of possible outputs here that I think we got, two of the outputs we got. One is a happy one, because you will see that the tempo is faster, and the notes sound more staccato, it's called. And there is vibratos in the long notes, and in the sad one you will see that the tempo is lower and the notes are more linked one to the other, and there are less crescendos than the happy one. There are quite significant difference between the two. Now, but this is the input. So the input, what basically happens is that each note sounds on tune, is playing correctly. But it's like a human player, let's assume, that does not know enough about, is not masterized enough the instrument, so he's capable of sound, of making it sound properly, but has no skills yet to add some personal touch. So he's not doing crescendos. The duration of the notes are exactly what the score says. The attack of the note, the note starts sounding when it should. It's 4x4, so one, two. If you do the one, if you keep track of the beat, you will see that they start sounding when they should, and they stop when they should. So there is no rhythmic variations, no timing deviations, nothing. However, in the happy and sad interpretation, there are lots of these. There are deviations in timing, in durations, in the energy of the notes. This is the happy one. There is wah, 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 wah. This is a vibrato that was not there before. There has been a crescendo here. And the black notes per minute, or the BPMs, it was here the tempo was faster than the input. And here the contrary, you will listen to a tempo which is slower than the input. The notes are very much linked here. One note starts sounding before the previous one really stops sounding. So if you look at the energy, the spectral energy, you will see that the energy is not zero. This vibrato, wow, it was of lower frequency than the previous one, than the happy one, and higher amplitude. So the vibrato is around the fundamental frequency of the note. You do some frequential variation on the frequency. So all these embellishments, if you want, or expressiveness that is added, and is added, the decisions are taken autonomously 100% by the system, as I said, by comparing the similarity between this score that it has to perform with the scores that have already been performed by a human player. Okay, now we come to this, which I think is one of the, in my opinion, maybe the main slides of this talk, is that all these achievements of weak AI, all those examples of weak AI, all of them, we have not always followed the paths that the founding fathers imagined. Okay, and even more recently, I mean, even more recently than in the last few years, we have seen this an impressive applications achievements in the one that maybe the last one is AlphaGo and Watson playing Jeopardy and many other things based on very large sets of data, or massive data-driven AI. And we have shifted from more cognitively plausible AI to an AI that is more based on lots of data and lots of statistical processing. I mean, nowadays, machine learning is basically dealing with lots of probabilistic statistical modeling, right? But not based on emulating human mental processes. So I, for example, DeepMind people say that their approach to AI is some sort of biological inspired, that is like the human brain works. Well, this is not quite true. I'm sorry for them, but a human being doesn't need to see 2 million images of a cat to recognize a cat. With only once, child sees only once a cat, and next time he sees a cat, will recognize a cat. See, that has nothing to do with deep mind's approach, right? With deep learning approach, for example, for image recognition. So the differences are extremely fundamental, in my opinion. So we cannot say that all these AI, impressive AI successes are based on emulating human mental processes at all. Okay, so here are some examples. As I say, AlphaGo, but also the self-driving cars, speech recognition systems, of course, Watson. And this, another example among many others that I could have picked up, I just picked up this one, that are based on analyzing massive amounts of data. I mean, it's good. I mean, it's good that we have these applications that are so nice, they perform so nicely. I applaud that. But I don't think that we should think that AI is that. AI, in my opinion, is much more than that. we have given up something very important in AI. So, in my opinion, there are three reasons why all these impressive results of AI are not getting us any closer to the general AI ideas at all. This is not contributing towards progressing towards general AI. Okay? And the first one of the reason, in my opinion, is very important, is that we have given up the explainability of the AI system. All these massive data-based, let's say, AI approaches are black boxes. They cannot explain why they took this decision or that decision and why they do the things they do, right? And this is a big problem, in my opinion. I'm giving up the why for simply the what, trading the why for the what, I think is not good for the future of AI. It's not good for the real scientific goal of AI, which is the reaching one day perhaps human level AI. This is not getting us much closer, not getting us any closer to that. A second reason why nowadays approaches to AI doesn't get us any closer to general AI is that we are focused too much on isolated components. We should think of AI as an integrated whole, an integrated system. We have wonderful bricks. We have the beautiful brick that does lots of great reasoning, a brick that is a machine learner that learns nicely, a brick that is a planner that wins the planning competition that is every year, as you know, a planning competition, the planning conferences. We have this wonderful brick, but we don't know how to build a house, okay? And we need architecture. We need a good architecture. It's surprising to me, at least, that I've been going to AI conferences the late 70s, that we don't see any more cognitive architectures in all these big AI conferences. For some reason, the cognitive architectures disappear. Before, there were very, very nice cognitive architectures that seemed promising, and now you don't see it anymore. So the focusing on isolated components, the fragmentation of the field of AI is a problem, in my opinion, too. Okay? And then there is a third big, big problem in AI, is that we have no idea how to model and acquire common sense knowledge. These are three limitations that will mark the future of AI. Okay? So let's talk a little bit about the future. No? Insisting on the integrated system approach, that we need that. No? We need to make these components of AI, components of intelligence, sensing, reasoning, learning, planning, communicating, socializing, etc. We need to think of this in a global way. You know? When we develop a system, we have to think that the machine learner will have to communicate with a reasoner or with a planner, you know, and vice versa, or with a perception system. That perception requires reasoning and learning. You cannot understand a scene if you don't do reasoning. You know, you cannot understand what is a cat by just analyzing millions of images of cats. This doesn't get you any closer to what the hell is a cat. I'm sorry, but it's not the case. So I think this integrated system, this integrated view of integrating all these components in an appropriate way, which, don't ask me, I don't know how. As I said, years ago, there were cognitive architectures that seemed promising, but have been more or less abandoned. So maybe we should recover some of these ideas of this cognitive architecture and see if we can, you know, nowadays we know a little bit more than before, at least from the bricks of the components, maybe we can recover some of these ideas of this old cognitive architecture. That could be a good way maybe to proceed. Okay, but I think these integrated systems are a necessary step towards this strong human level AI. Well, this is a simple example of an obvious example of an integrated system. Anyone that works in robotics has to deal with integrated systems, even if he doesn't want to deal with. Because a robot is something that will be in a physical environment, not a simulated robot, a real robot, okay? We'll have to struggle with perception problems, from perception to action. In the middle, it will need some planner, because the robot will have to do some movements, will achieve some tasks. The robot will have to learn, because you cannot tell them in advance everything. He can encounter many unforeseeable situations, and the robot will have to be able to learn, basically, right? See, there are some of the requirements that such a robot, this we call multi-purpose robot, otherwise it would be again in the specific site. I don't want to be specific. I want to be more general AI approach. And, you know, it has to deal with these issues. And all this, nothing of this has been solved yet, you know? And in particular, I highlight three different things here. Common sense, deep natural language understanding, and reliable computer vision systems. But what is interesting is that these two, both the deep natural language understanding, and not Watson. Watson doesn't understand anything of what he may answer the question rightly, again, by using massive data approaches, but doesn't understand anything of language at all. And also the computer vision system, they both depend on the common sense bottleneck. They require common sense. Without common sense knowledge, you cannot understand natural language truly, and you cannot understand what you see truly. Okay. If you have a robot at your home in the future, you know, and you assume this waiter robot, you don't want the robot to do what is written there, right? And for that, we are not quite yet there. Huh? Or the second example, in a cleaning robot, okay, shouldn't run over or sweep the little cat, yeah? Look at, these are some examples of the state-of-the-art image recognition. A man sitting in a bench with a dog. This is what the system believes. That is this guy, this child playing with a baseball bat. A red and white bus in front of a building. Not even the color got right. A young boy is holding a baseball bat. That's one. So this kind of huge failures should make us think a lot about all these approaches to AI that are not based on knowledge, that are only based on analyzing millions of images. And that's why they made these big mistakes, because there is no common sense behind. Or look at this translation. This is last week translation. In Spanish, in English working, you say the electrician is working, the telephone is working, that's correct. But in Spanish, the telephone is functioning, would be the working would be functioning, and in case of a human being, working should be, I mean working, laboring, doing some labor. So in Spain there are two different, is an ambiguity, so trabajando y funciona, okay? So this is good, one and two are, the translation is correct, by the way, for those of you that don't know Spanish, but if I put a few words in between, so if I had that was repaired by the electrician is now working. If I say that, the Spanish translation makes a big mistake because says that it thinks that working here instead of referring to the telephone, which is what is the right meaning, it believes that it refers to the electrician. Okay, so here instead of trabajando, should say funcionando in Spanish. That's a very basic, big mistake. Look, in this very simple sentence, already this big mistake. So Google Translator is again the same problem. Doesn't understand at all language, at all. Okay? And we need to go much farther than that. We need to deal with the semantics, and then we need to deal with this common sense knowledge. Okay? And one way of dealing with common sense knowledge, there are many ways have been tried to deal with this problem, like trying to put manually all the knowledge in the system. Well, this is hopeless. Or trying to do this crawlers that go around and the internet and identifies named entities and tries to relate them with other things that appear in the text, like the never-ending language learning at CMU, for example. But these have been so far failure. And there is a new approach which consists in putting the robot in experimenting, the robot experiments, what is called developmental robotics, with its environment, and tries to learn by experience. And here we have an assistant that learns about to associate positions of the finger, of the hand, of the robot with sounds, and is capable of learning how to play a musical instrument. That is, in that case, the instrument is a keyboard, but is a simulated keyboard. It's not a real keyboard. It's a touch-sensitive screen, and so it is a virtual keyboard. And explores the instrument. So the robot, what does here, I don't know if you can listen anything here. No, something should be sounding here. Anyway, he's randomly shooting his finger, and then whenever he listens to the first sound, the next time he will put the finger nearby, instead of going to somewhere else very fast. So if at some position I hear something, chances are that in nearby positions that I will hear something. And then here, after some exploration, he is capable of identifying the 14 notes that sound, these 14 different notes. Once he has learned by active learning to associate positions and sounds, you can tell him, now you play this melody, ta-da-di-do-da. You tell him to tell the robot the melody, and the robot is capable of reproducing the melody almost without errors. We couldn't listen to it. I don't know why, but it doesn't matter. Anyway, so I'm finishing now. I think that the road ahead of AI is, there are plenty of work to do, have in front of us. We have to deal with integrated system, with common sense reasoning. And these are very, very big problems. There are some ambitious predictions for some of my colleagues. Some of them are quite curious and maybe a little bit hilarious, like a team of robots will beat the world's human soccer champion team by Hiroaki Kitano. He said, but in 2050 or so. Well, so that means that the world's, there will be a soccer team by robots that will win the Barca, which I'm not sure that this is really possible. Something that I will not spend time here, but I have some slides, but we can talk about that if later you want, that AI will benefit from progress in biology, in material science, nanotechnology, to deal with problems, challenges on humanoid robots that you want to have humanoid robots at home one day, we will have them. And we don't want these robots to be very noisy. So there is an example of muscles that are artificial muscles that don't produce any noise at all, which is based on hydrogen. Cartilags that are based on nanotechnology, by nano brushes, which have water molecules that avoid friction. So, and then this is interesting because it performs well in pressures. In pressures that are similar to the pressure that a human knee, for example, is supporting for a human being. Touch-sensitive artificial skins. This is also progressing very, very fast. So I think that all this will change quite a lot the situation of AI by these interdisciplinary connections with other fields. Now I'm finished already. Let's see. It's clear that we have, AI has proven that it's an established research discipline, that we have lots of impressive results on this weak AI, okay? But strong AI, in my opinion, is something that is still very far if one day we may achieve it. So don't pay too much attention to people that talk about singularity, right? So don't keep calm and forget about singularity. It's true also that AI techniques are everywhere and sometimes are not visible, as I said. and AI algorithms increasingly run our lives. That should make me pose some questions, some even ethical questions. As I said, there are opportunities on interdisciplinary approaches between AI and other fields. And then I think the AI is mature enough to undertake again the research on cognitive architectures as that I was mentioning earlier, and dealing with integrated systems, and not only working on massive data-driven AI, which will not lead us towards general and strong AI. Thank you.